when I moved to LA, I sort of reconnected with a guy named Stephen Prince, who I'd met in Texas. And he was actually the subject of the lost Scorsese film, the one documentary that has never really been released and had a proper release. And we started hanging out and just drinking and watching movies. And he's a very engaging storyteller. And so I started to get the idea that he still had more to tell. And it was sort of the film school that I always wanted but never had. And so I got the idea that I was going to make a movie about the years that he spent living with Martin Scorsese and talking about the film and really trying to understand why he left the film industry at that point.
Just a second. I just want to read you what this says here. After a great deal of research we did in the whole thing, Steve tells about filling a pitcher with vodka.
We better
cut that out. Note to the editor. We better cut that out because we'll blow the end here. Okay. You want to tell the story?
Yeah. My mother, without a doubt, cooks the most bland food in the world. No taste at all. No taste.
This man is saying that about his mother.
Right.
Forget what we were doing. This is really good. Oh, Christ. This is not bad.
Bar of soap?
This is better than... This is good.
Oh, yeah.
This is good.
Yeah.
Not bad.
Not at all.
Could you go over there to that side, please?
Oh, certainly.
Woo!
I'm guilty, huh?
We're all guilty, God knows.
What are you doing now?
When I was in college, because I was studying philosophy and, I wasn't in film school, but I had a very deep interest in filmmaking. And at the time, at the University of Texas, they had film screenings, but they didn't check IDs when you went in. So I started to sneak into the film screenings for the film students. And I was very lucky and fortunate to see three by Scorsese, which were American Boy, Italian American, and The Big Shave. And I was really struck by American Boy. And after that, I had gotten a bootleg VHS copy, which was the only way sort of filmmakers had it, and it had a huge influence on American cinema and on filmmakers in general through this bootleg tape. So like the scene in Pulp Fiction where they put the adrenaline shot into Uma Thurman's chest is directly taken out of an experience that Stephen Prince had and told Scorsese in the documentary American Boy.
You know how you give an adrenaline shot? Okay, your adrenaline needle's like about that big, and you got to give it into the heart. And you have to put it in a stabbing motion and then plunge down on a thing.
She's got a breastplate. So you got to pierce through that. So what you got to do is you got to bring the needle down in a stabbing motion.
I got to stab her three times?
No, you don't got to fucking stab her three times. You got to stab her once, but it's got to be hard enough to get through her breastplate into her heart. All right? And then once you do that, you press down on the plunger.
Okay, then what happens?
I got the medical dictionary out, looked it up. Got a magic marker, made a magic marker on where her heart was, measured down like two or three ribs, and measured in between there, and I just stood there and I went. And then, and she came back like that. She just came right back like that.
When I was a student, I was managing an art house movie theater, and I became involved in sort of projecting art films. And there's an Austin Film Society there that Richard Linklater was running. So I knew him from the screenings for the Austin Film Society, as well as coming into the movies in my theater. And one day, I was walking outside of a coffee shop, and he said, "Hey, you know, you want to help me make this movie?" And we went back inside, and he showed me this big piece of paper, which looked insane at the time. I mean, it didn't look anything like a script or anything that resembled traditional filmmaking. And what it was basically the blueprints, which later became Slacker.
A video image is much more powerful and useful than an actual event. Like, back when I used to go out, when I was last out, I was walking down the street, and this guy, like, came barreling out of a bar, fell right in front of me, and he had a knife right in his back. Landed right on the ground. And Well, I have no reference to it now. I can't refer back to it. I can't press rewind. I can't put it on pause. I can't put it on slow-mo and see all the little details. And the blood, it was all wrong. It didn't look like blood. And the hue was off, and I couldn't adjust the hue. I was seeing it for real, but it just wasn't right.
And I wasn't interested in being in the film, but he convinced me to be in it by telling me that if I wanted to know what it was going to be like to be behind the camera, I had to really know what it was like to be in front of the camera.
Say, pal, did I overhear you say you got a friend that's missing?
Well, I doubt he's missing. He's just not around.
Oh, yeah, well, I've been reading in the World Weekly News, you know, just a little while ago. There was a guy out here on the street. He's found wandering around, didn't know who he was, didn't know where he came from, anything like that. Oh, he's perfectly healthy, but he's complete amnesiac, you know. A lot of people like that found just wandering around lately. You know, no history, no nothing. It's weird, huh?
I was actually in Slacker as well as being a PA on it. And then from there, we just became good friends, and he was always aware of the projects that I did. And when we started talking about collaborating, we started to throw ideas around, and then Waking Life was born from that, which was a feature film. That sort of brought some of the animation stuff that I had been experimenting with to his filmmaking ability.
I'm going to tell you about a dream I once had. I know that's, you know, when someone says that, that's usually you're in for a very boring next few minutes, and you might be, but it sounds like, you know, what else are you going to do, right? Anyway, I read this essay by Philip K. Dick.
What, you read it in your dream?
No, I read it before the dream. It was the preamble to the dream. It was about that book, Flow My Tears, the Policeman Said. You know that one?
Yeah, he won an award for that one.
Right. That's the one he wrote really fast. It just, like, flowed right out of him. He felt he was sort of channeling it or something. But anyway, about 4 years after it was published, he was at this party, and he met this woman who had the same name as the woman character in the book. And she had a boyfriend with the same name as the boyfriend character in the book. And she was having an affair with this guy, you know, the chief of police. And he had the same name as the chief of police in his book. So she's telling him every, you know, all this stuff from her life, and everything she's saying is right out of his book. So that's really freaking him out, but, you know, what can he do?
While we were making Waking Life, we were talking about Philip K. Dick a lot. At the time, I'd been a huge fan ever since, like, my late teens. And Rick was also a fan, and we were talking about how different he was from all the other sci-fi writers. And there's even a scene in Waking Life where Rick's talking about Philip K. Dick. And we were interested in making a movie called Ubik at the time, and I'd sort of started to pursue the rights, and the rights issues were a problem. And then we quickly switched to Scanner Darkly and started to develop that as a feature film.
It may just be my imagination. Whatever it is that's watching, it's not human.
Gentlemen, you are about to witness for approximately 61 cents the perfect homemade silencer.
A Jurism silencer.
And how did you first meet Stephen Prince himself?
We had a mutual friend, and she was getting some construction done on her house. And she told me that the contractor had been a Scorsese's producer and was in some of his films, and I didn't believe her at the time. So she finally convinced me to come over and meet him, and as soon as I went there, I recognized him immediately, and I told him that I'd seen American Boy, and he sort of came at me menacingly and, you know, demanding where I'd seen the movie, because nobody was supposed to have seen the film. It never got the proper release. I sort of explained to him how I saw it on the college campus and, you know, how I was a huge fan of it. And then he sort of settled down, and then from that point on, we sort of started to develop a friendship.
When I went around the table, what everybody's opinion was, what we could do to shorten it up. And it came to me, and I said, that was the last one, I said, we have to attack our minor characters. That's what we have to do. Right? And he says, right. We get up, went in the editing room, takes my 11 minutes in New York, New York. Puts it on the machine, puts his foot on the pedal, and spins my 11 minutes off the steam vac onto the wall, stops it, cuts it, boom, it's that, right, that was it, total, everything, gone,
the reason why I did this was because I loved the original film so much, and I thought it was so great, and it deserved a wider audience. As far as like showing it to Scorsese, I'd love for him to see it, because I think intention really comes through, and you know, you hope not to piss off a major film icon in doing that. And my belief is that he'll recognize the intention, you know, behind it, and that he'll realize it's a companion piece to his film. So I hope he sees it. I don't know how to get it to him. I mean, one thought is just to release it BitTorrent and let it go viral, and hope he sees it that way.